This world knows when you've been with Jesus.
Know what I mean? Praise God.
Praise God.
give you praise, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. Come on, can we just worship him right now? Hallelujah. Can you love him right now? Hallelujah. That's what it's all about, folks. I know it's cute and beautiful and wonderful, but it really is about teaching our kids how to entertain the presence of God and usher in an anointing and learn how to connect in worship. Hallelujah. Seated. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Anybody know what greatest hits stands for? Any adults know what greatest hits stand for? You know, it really does make a difference when adults try to know stuff like that, you know, really, because I promise you, young people know, you know, they feel support or not, they feel love or not. Praise God. And I appreciate how a lot of these young people minister to us each and every service, or at least very often, you know what I mean? So praise God. It's good to support when you can support us. Praise God. So praise the Lord. Anybody know the name of the youth group? Uh-oh. Has to do with the book of Romans. Uh-oh. No. Praise God. It's all right. Praise the Lord. We'll get to that later, maybe. Praise God. Are you glad you came to church today? Hallelujah. Anybody got something better to be doing right now? Praise God. Man. Thank you, Jesus. The last special speaker we had was talking about how not every place has stuff like this. Where we are willing to put our energy and finances and time creates a failure or success for the next generation. Yes. Ultimately, it's up to them, yes, but you know we lay the groundwork, right? So praise God. Thank you for supporting, and praise God, coming today to worship God. This is not really unlike any other service. It's all about Jesus. God, here, come have your way. Have your way. Do what you want to do through me, through us. Praise the Lord. Anybody else want to glorify the Lord real quick? Just real quick. I believe it. Right. That's true. Praise God. There you go. Oh, that's the key. You don't stop at rebuking it. You replace it with worship. All right. Praise God. Let's go. Dear God.
You know, our God can replace
anything. Tell it.
It can replace.
Yes.
Self-pity. It can replace.
Right.
Come on.
Anything
man.
That you want it to replace. Anything you want it to replace. And I just love him because you know what? He didn't die on that cross for nothing. And that keeps coming to me. He did not die on that cross. We were talking about this
right.
morning. Everybody's different. Everybody's got a different walk. God knows every individual the way they are. And how they're going to grow. And I just hate him because, you know, he didn't put the crown of thorns. He didn't take the nails to the hands and feet for him. He didn't do it.
Right. He became sin for us.
He did it for the world. And half of the world doesn't even believe in him, you know, but he still did it for them. And I just want to love him. I love him as an unconditional.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost so... Jesus. God, I love you. I love you. Dude, come on. Let's go. Praise God. They're doing something with... Again, you already know this is worship. Somebody say worship. Praise God. Praise God. Brother Larry, I will have you testify. I will not forget you. I saw you. Praise God. Praise God. Let's take a moment right now and just lift our hands and give God some praise. Can we do that in Jesus' name? Oh, yes, Lord. I love you. Go, go, go. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Come.
Feel it in the atmosphere. The Spirit of the Lord is here.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. I praise the name. I praise your name, Jesus. Oh, I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you, Lord. Hey, I know we've proven we can praise and worship when there's music bumping and there's a kids choir and there's something like that. I wonder if there's any true worshipers in here that can just lift him up because he's in the house right now without anybody else doing anything. Hallelujah. I can move into my closet with God and it's me and him and things are intimate and I can worship him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, Jesus. All I need is you. All I need is you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Are you glad that you go to a spirit-filled church? Yeah. What kind of church do you go to? Oh, we're a spirit. Some people say, oh, you wonder sometimes, but praise God. Hallelujah. You begin, if you never feel it in there, I don't know how you, but praise God, every service we can feel. We can feel, well, it's his house. It only makes sense to feel the one that's supposed to be here first. The house of God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Brother Larry, did you still have that testimony you want to give? Praise God.
I'm going to tell you right now, something happened last Sunday.
Uh-huh.
Something fell away.
Praise.
Nicotine addictions way too long.
Tell it, bro.
53 years ago, I suffered. I got it last night. Right there.
Yeah.
Just fell away.
Amen.
Just fell away.
Tell it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is God. Do I have to say it again? When he rose up, he had victory over everything. And his blood covers every sin. Praise God. And when our will comes into alignment with his will, even though as the disciples had to learn, certain things can't get broke down, but by prayer and fasting, there still is a way to do that. When our will joins his, stuff like that seems to happen on a random Sunday night. Brother Larry, are you telling me that you weren't up here in the middle of everything? You weren't getting anointed by the man of God? You weren't? It was just you and Jesus in a corner.
That's it.
My God.
Better worship.
Yeah.
I've been repeating this for like 3 months, y'all. There is power. Chains break in worship. Some people don't believe me when I say it until you start doing it. And guess what? You walk away going, you know what? He might have been right about that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. And I'll say it again. He doesn't love Brother Larry more than he loves anybody else in here. Praise the Lord. It is his will. Praise God. Hey, it isn't it? It's his will that we have victory. And sometimes we can come and we can go, okay, God, give me deliverance. And sometimes it doesn't work in that fashion. Do you know how many battles that the children of God had to fight? Let's go Old Testament, easy to relate to, right? That they actually had to fight. God didn't just deliver them. But when God did deliver them, do you see the preparation that usually was made? There was great steps of faith in action that made no sense. Right. Let's send out the praisers. Let's glory again. Do I got to do this right now? there's power in praise. When you focus on God, not your problem, things begin to happen. Or let's just go around the wall. Let's just go around the walls of Jericho and God brings deliverance, right? How much sense did that make to go around the walls of Jericho? Let's just march. Let's just do it again. Let's just, hey, Naaman, go dip in a muddy river. This makes no sense. I thought the man of God, I'm all high, I know what's going on. I thought the man of God would come over and do it the way I thought he was going to do it. And he told him to, it's the last thing this proud man wanted to do. But he was riddled with a disease that affected every area of his life. And he kept it hidden by his armor. Could I preach right now or what? He kept it hidden. He kept it hidden by walls. He kept it hidden by his perceived status in the army. And I'm over you and I'm over you. But still, he was a dead man on the inside. Until he decided to simply do it God's way, even though it made no sense. Hey, before he fully understood something, I tell you what, there's still power in your obedience. Because that's what really proves your faith. That's what, the Bible says we can't even please God without faith. Our faith is proven by our actions.
Yes.
Well, praise God. Praise God. You know, I don't think, and listen, I know, folks, I know it's dangerous. I know it's dangerous to start giving compliments sometimes. All right, but I don't think Brother Larry would be upset if he wasn't the only man that came down at his lunchtime and sought the face of God every day. You can't for a moment convince me that that doesn't play into stuff like this. You can't convince me of that. Because the more I wish I had a whole lot of time right now. But the more time you spend with Jesus, the more clarity you have about yourself and about his will in your life. And he magnifies, and he reveals problems, and not only does he reveal problems, he reveals how to take care of it. And you know what usually taking care of it consists of? Partially spending even more time with him. Yeah. Because the more time I spend with somebody, the more I become like them. Yeah. You become more like her because you've been married. You become more like him. The more time we spend in the presence, oh, come on. Does anybody know who I'm talking about? He's the King. He's the Savior. He's your Father. He loves you. Spending more time. This is why I get upset and I get freaked out. And oh, your pastor, you're overreacting when people disconnect in any way, because that's cracking the door open to more disconnection from the presence of God. And I understand that the presence of God is our only hope. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. We better move on right there. Praise God. I'm in this to win. You feel me? I'm not in this to be. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. Prayer request real quick. Sister Cass. Amen. Yeah. Jesus' name. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, Jesus. Lord, help her, please. Oh, my goodness. Tell her to quit tripping. Sister. Amen. Sister Julie, did I see your hand? Okay. All right. On that note, praise the Lord. There was one other little thing. What was it? You know, pray for one another. Does anybody actually pray for people in this body individually? Please do. Please do. We're trying to survive round two of testing right now. There better not be a round three. That's all I got to say. But you know what helps us not have a round three? When we pass the tests in round two. God don't just for fun send us stuff, right? Praise the Lord. Let's pray in Jesus' name. God, we love you. We worship you. Thank you for your spirit that is in this place. Thank you, God, for hungry hearts. that are here to worship you and focus on the answer. Focus on you, Lord. You are the giver of life. You are the source of all my hope. God, you are the repairer of all my brokenness, Jesus. And I want you to know I love you today. I put all my needs, all these requests, all these great people in your hand. God, let me do my part. Help us to do our part, God. And we'll give you praise because we know you are going to do yours if we'll let you. We love you, Lord. And we thank you for this service. Thank you for these young people. In Jesus' mighty name, we love you, God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. If you have tithe or offering, if you have your pledge, your pledges, please don't forget about that. We are very hesitant to make any purchases and do anything before we kind of know that we're going to be, you know what I'm saying. So please remember that. And praise God. We love you. If you need prayer, come get it. Love one another. Greet one another in Jesus' name.
My God is more than enough. He can supply all my needs. He is my El Shaddai. He always looks after me. Jehovah Jireh. He is my God. My God is more than enough. He can supply all my needs. He is my El Shaddai. He always looks after me. Jehovah Jireh. He is my God.
They just set the stage for me to say something. I'm not sure what that would be, though, at this particular point in time. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, that was a good song. Praise God. I was hoping we'd sing that one more. But you know, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God kind of put something on my heart here, and it ties into everything that we've been kind of discussing here the last couple minutes. You know, and you may think this doesn't apply to you, but at some point it will, if it doesn't at this moment. You know, we come to God so often and we pray knowing that God is, kind of like the song was saying, my God is not just enough, which would be enough. I mean, right? If he's enough, he's enough. But he's even more than enough. And that's what we know, right? And so we come to God and we can have requests and say, God, help me with this. Deliver. Remember, sometimes there's a deliverance, but sometimes there's a working through it. Right? Matter of fact, the Bible indicates that if... you'll find I'm right if you don't understand what scriptures I'm talking about, but it indicates that if God would have given an instant deliverance, it would have destroyed his people. Uh-huh. And you better believe God knows you better than you know you. So we can say it all. We can say it all day. Okay, God, well, why don't you do it this way? Why don't you do it that way? God knows best. Okay. But the Bible, you know, we see people coming to Jesus, and we've heard this before, as your faith is, so be it unto you. Okay? If I'm praying for somebody who doesn't have the Holy Ghost, right? Now, we already know faith gets God's attention, doesn't matter who you are. Now, if you repent, praise God, even better. But faith at all, it gets God kind of on the scene. So if I'm praying for somebody that doesn't have the Holy Ghost, doesn't even know really anything about what this all is about, all right, it's going to have a lot more to do with me, perhaps, than the person here. But when I'm praying for somebody that has the Holy Ghost, that dynamic kind of shifts to the individual. As the faith of that individual is, okay, there's a reason why it says, if you're sick, you call for the elders. It doesn't say the elders got to come seek you out and say, hey, looks like you're sick, let me pray. No, see, because that in itself is an act of faith. I'm going to believe what the Word of God said, and I'm going to come, and I'm going to say, okay, pray for me. But if you have the Spirit of God within you, as your faith is, so be it unto you. And our faith is demonstrated by our actions, but not just in this moment. Do you hear me? Not just in the moment of I'm here to receive deliverance or help or whatever the case is. Our actions yesterday and our actions last week and our lifestyle of faithfulness. Our lifestyle of faithfulness comes into our moment of faith. So be it unto you as your faith has demonstrated. There's a reason why when they came to Jesus said we couldn't get this job done. Okay, well, it comes not out but by prayer and fasting. And then Jesus just turned and got it done. That proves that whole thing right there. He had already been praying and fasting. He didn't say, hold on, I got to go try to get my faith alive because faith without works is a corpse. It is dead. I got to get my faith working so I have enough faith to do this miracle. He had already been doing what it takes. That's where lifestyle comes in. That's where staying connected comes in. And so we come and we have an opportunity to let our faith be used in our own benefit. And as your faith is, so be it unto you. I hope somebody understood all of that. And can I take it out of the spiritual for just a moment? In that whole concept that I just explained. Whether you're the one praying for somebody or you're the one with the Spirit of God saying, God, help me with whatever it is. When you are living a connected life to God, your confidence alone can be a game changer. your confidence. If all you're doing is staying in the negative, surrounding yourself with negative people, getting caught up in the ways of darkness, or so many other things we could be opting for rather than just staying in that. That's why it says pray without ceasing. Kind of stay in a zone. And guys and ladies, I've had lots of jobs, and I know how it is. You have to focus on your job. You have to all this kind of stuff. But I'm here to also tell you, you can also still stay connected at the same time that you go through your whole 8-hour day. One of the things that I liked about my driving jobs have been, Brother Chris, it's me and God. I don't gotta let nobody else in for the majority of my day. I can focus as much. I can get fed. I can feed him with my worship. I can work on that. Man, we can stay connected. And it pays off. My God. Praise God. Can we just worship him right now? Jesus, let our faith be what it needs to be. Let our lifestyle, let our connection, let our love for you, let it override the call, the false, empty call of this world. Oh, Jesus, my hunger, my love for you, Jesus. Oh, God, if I'm going to be with you forever, I want to fall in love with you like never before right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I give you praise. I give you praise, God. Praise God. Praise God. Jesus, 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 we love you. We love you, God. Thank you for your help. Thank you for your spirit, God. It's called the Comforter. It's called the Comforter, an ever-present help in trouble. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Not only is the Word of God the number one best-selling book in the world, never, never, never to be beaten. ain't nobody going to surpass that. Harry Potter, get your garbage out of here. Parents, don't let stupid stuff like that in your house. Get your garbage TVs out of there, because it's just a hose, a spigot of poison for your children. I could really go into some things right now that I know about the programming and its perversions, but just take my word for it if you want to. Praise God. It's wrapped in a safe. Oh, it's okay. It's made for kids. Our enemy has been at this a long, 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 long time. He's real good at it, and he's real cutthroat. The sooner he can get your kids, the better. And he's trying real hard. Praise God. Praise God. So thank God for the Word of God. No matter who brings it, it's still forever settled in heaven, right? Praise God. Brother Zach is coming to impart whatever God has given to him. I am hungry for the Word of God. The messenger matters, all right? But what really matters is our hunger and ability to receive from his word that is not changed. He's not bringing us a new word, right? He's coming from the word. We're bringing the word here. Praise God. So we can put faith in that at the very least. Praise God. Why don't you put your hands together for the Lord here today? In Jesus' name.
Praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
beautiful presence in this place. Hallelujah. This isn't a new message. It's new that God showed me, but it's not new as you're saying. It's a very strong one, though. Simple. But at the same time, it is very hard to... It was very hard to bring together. The messenger, just by bringing in the couple messages I've had, I understand how hard it is for the man of God to bring together a message. I'm going to destroy. God, what do you want me to preach? Pulling together the message, the droplets that God says, I want you to preach this, pull it together, piece it together and make it into one piece, his masterpiece. I thank God for the honor of being able to be up here behind the desk. I thank God for what he's doing in my life, for what he's giving to me. But I thank God for a man of God who has to do this every single time he has to get up. Every single time. And he not only has to worry about the message, but he also has to worry about counseling, about taking care of the flock, about reaching out, taking care of the church. There's a whole lot more that a man of God has to take care of. And it's hard enough for me. Imagine being him. Wow. The first verse I'm going to go with today is in the book of Job, chapter 6, verse 11. Amen. Job chapter 6, 11. What is my strength that I should hope? What is my end that I should prolong my life? Amen. You can go ahead and be seated in the name of Jesus. Amen. Job was at that time, he had all his stuff taken away from his wife. It was right there miserable with him, saying, why don't you just curse God and die? His children were all dead. Everything stolen from him. Just curse God and die. His friends were coming and saying, why are you dealing with this? Just curl up and die. Just get away with it. But he was saying, why should I hope? Why should I prolong my life? Why? How many times in the middle of a trial are you asking, why should I go and pray? Why should I prolong it? Why don't I just end it right now? There's reasons. The word hope, this specific meaning of word hope, means to wait, to be patient, to tarry. He's asking, why should I tarry here? Why should I be patient on God? There's just something specific about asking, why? Because the more I stay with God, the more I will continue and he will prolong my life. I've seen people that have been following after God their whole life. They're reaching into old age. They've had a nice long life. And I've seen people, they started out in the church, backslid, and they died at a young age. because of what they could have done at that young age could have prolonged their life so much further. That every single little thing that happens in the world is really a test and really a way of, should I do this? Well, if you do this, your life will be shortened or your life will be lengthened. You'll live to the life that God wants you to, or you'll die younger. It's a matter of eternity, because in the matter of a long life, you have a nice long life, you can develop wisdom, knowledge, and strength. In the middle of a storm, you don't see who you truly are. You see what you are at that moment. I'm ground up. I'm nothing. It's like in the middle of a restoration of an old classic car. You're in the middle of the restoration. It looks like nothing. Paint is all sanded off. It's a nice dull body. Doesn't look that great. The engine's out of it. Tires, there's no tires for it. But you're in the middle. You're in the middle of a trial, of that storm that's going on, and you can't see what it will become in the end. In the book of Psalms, chapter 31 and 24, it says, "Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart, all ye that hope in the Lord." It's a little more than just waiting. That's what hope means. It's a little more than waiting. You're tarrying for God. And to tarry means to prepare, to meet, to be ready. It's not just about, you know what, I'm just going to come over here. I'm going to have guests coming. I'm going to sit down, relax. They'll get here when they get here. But instead, you're going about your house. You're cleaning up every single little nook and cranny. I see some dust in there. I need to sweep that out. I see a cobweb up there. I need to dust that out. Get it out of there. When we're waiting on God in the midst of a trial, it's a little more of, yeah, it may be hard to meet him. It's a little hard to, it feels like I'm punching a brick wall. Feels like I can't get through. But God, trial is just a test. It's just a way of reaching through. And when you're in that trial, you have to be prepared. You have to be ready for whatever may come. You have to pray. You have to seek God's face. You have to follow after him no matter what may come. In the middle of the trial, you are questioning, should I just end it? Should I? There's a gun right there. Should I just stick the thing in my mouth, pull the trigger? Should I grab those pills, throw it in my mouth, just end it? I'm sick and tired of the pain I'm feeling right now. Should I The marriage isn't lasting like it should be. Should I end it? It's not doing very great. We're fighting all the time. But should I end it? Should I just quit while I'm ahead? This job, it's not working out for me. Should I end it? You know, I'm halfway through developing what God wants me to be. Should I end it? We are a little more than just a person. We are the holy temple. We are the living, breathing church that God has provided us to be. He handmade us. He preformed us. He thought of us centuries before we were even thought of. He knew what we were going to be. He had already planned out a divine leading and guiding path for each and every single one of us. When we are going along the way, it's like, it's more or less, should I end what God wants me to be? Should I end the temple of God? It's more than just about us. But we have to be hoping, waiting, tarrying, be preparing for the next step that may come our way. In the end, we will be stronger, wiser, have more knowledge in the end of when we come out of that struggle, out of that trial. We'll be ready for the next thing down the road. We'll be stronger. There'll that person be coming out. They're having the same struggle we had. You know what we can do? We can say, you know what? I had that same problem. I will help you out. I'm going to pull you out while I'm still here. I'm going to be the one. You know what? I see that you've fallen. I see your marriage is going down. I see, you know what? You're struggling with pills, knives, guns. You're about ready to end your own life. But I will help you. I will pull you out. I'll pull you up. I will be your stepping stone so you can be stronger in life than you ever were. Yes. This is about hoping on God. In the storm, in the eye of the storm, you'll reach a calm. When a tornado's coming through, there's a calm right in that middle. And you'll think, oh, everything's doing all right now. And then you'll get hit. Boom. And you'll think, oh, great. Here I am again. Here I am going again. I thought it was over. No. You're in the calm, that rest. And you're hit again. And you're going again. God, just end it, please. Why don't you hear me? Job was asking that same question. But it's just a test. It's a trial to lead you through. In the end, when Job won the trial, when he made it through, he refused to curse God and die. He refused to bend to his friends that said, you know what, just give up. He refused to. In the end, he had twice as many children. He had twice as many crops, twice as many livestock, twice as rich. He was twice as strong because he lasted. Because he said, I'm not going to give up hoping. I'm not going to give up trying. I'm not going to give up praying. I don't care. God, here I am. Take me. I don't care whether I'm hit a brick wall. I don't care if I feel like I might fall off the edge. You know what, God? I'm pulling myself back. I'm pulling myself to you. And in the end, we will become stronger than we ever will be. We will become the saints. We will become the army of God. Going out to attack what the devil may put in our way. We'll be there pulling the people up out of the street saying, you know what? You don't have to deal with that. You don't have to deal with the struggle. You don't have to deal with pornography, with a marriage that's falling apart, drugs, deception, none of that. You don't have to deal with throwing the gang sign and feel like you're about to get knocked off. You don't have to worry about that. You don't have to worry about, oh, I feel like I'm not doing right, you know. What will they think? No. You could be yourself. You could be the one God wanted you to be when you were first born, when you were first created, when he thought, you know what, I will make myself another temple. I will make myself a sacrifice. He will be one. She will be one to learn and to develop and to lead people through to the promised land. There will be the ones to bring people back to heaven, back to me. I love them so much. I need another temple to go out, to reach out, and to reach them. Because if we don't hope in the midst of the storm, we will lose track. We will die off spiritually and physically and mentally. It's not about, you know what, I'll just quit while I'm ahead before I get any worse. No, no, no. It's about I'm creating another temple, stronger, better than ever before. I'm creating something much more powerful than he ever think he will be. He will, my power will be through him. His anointing put over that person will be greater than they would have ever dreamed. When you think, God, why do you want to use me? Why do you want to use a piece of filth of like me? A person who struggled with so many different things, and it's like, God, why me? There's a reason why. Because your story will be like none other. There's a person that walks before you, the person that walks behind you. They have a completely different story. He needs your story. Not their story. There's a reason why he created you beyond anything you could imagine. He brings them out of smoking, out of drinking. He brings them out because he's like, you know what? There's a person out on the street walking by. I need that person to go grab them because, you know what? They're delivered from drinking. They have a drinking problem. I'm going to need them to go reach out to them. Oh, that person that's smoking, I need them to reach out to the person that's smoking. Oh, that person that had struggled with pornography, I need them to go reach the person struggling with pornography. Person dealing with depression, I need that person to go and deal with that depression. He needs you. He's picked you more than he ever picked that next person. He needs them just as much. But he needs you more with just your specific talent, your specific testimony, your specific temple. That's why he creates each and every single one of us the same. So we can create and then he can mold us out to what he wants us to be. We can branch out. Yeah, we may look a lot alike. But you know what? We're all different. He has taken that clay pot. Have you ever looked at the clay pots that they make, the potteries? Every single one is just slightly different than the next one down the road. Every single one, they may look a lot alike from a first glance. You glance at them, oh, look at all those pots. They all look alike. You pull out that magnifying glass and you start looking over them. That line's different from that line. That line, oh, there's a slight dip in that one where there isn't one. There's a slight bump on that one where there isn't in that one. Each one is just different. And each and every single one. And that's why we need a hope in the midst of the storm. Because we're going to come out stronger. We are going to come out greater than what we would have ever dreamed. We need to be saying, God, I need to wait on you. Help me, God, to wait on you. Just go ahead and lift up your hands right now and just talk to God. Oh yes, Jesus. Wait on me, God. I need to wait on you like never before, Jesus. I need to tarry in your presence, God. Oh yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. I need to be the temple you want me to be, God. Oh, hallelujah. If you want to go ahead, come to the altar, you can come. If you just want to go ahead, stand up, find a quick place to pray and just say, God, I need you. I need to tarry with you, Jesus. Oh, yes, Jesus. I want to be that temple you want me to be. I want to be the one that you want me to be. Use me like never before, God. Make me the way you want me to be, Jesus. Oh, yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God.
Jesus at the center of
to be able to last through the storm, Jesus. Help me, God, to give me strength enough just to the end so I can see what you want me to be, what you made me to be, God. Oh, yes, Jesus. Yes,
Jesus.
We thank you, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus.
Jesus at
Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, there is no once saved, always saved. There's relationship. There's connection. Praise God. The bride is predestined. Hallelujah. There will be a bride. I just want to make sure my relationship with Jesus is strong enough that makes me a part of that body. Praise God. Hallelujah. I said, I want my lifestyle to equal a strong enough relationship with Him that puts me a part of that predestined body of Christ. Hallelujah. The Bible says there's a good and acceptable and a perfect. That's what Brother Zach talking about. He said, man, he made you and he already knew how you could become. Your best, what your best looks like. Your hallelujah. There is a perfect will. God, I want to attain to that. I don't want to just be satisfied at a good level. But God, I want to ascend to acceptable. Isn't it funny that acceptable is below good? We can say, well, I'm doing good. But still be so out of the will of God, it's not even acceptable. That equals rejectable. You can be doing good and still be rejected. But thank God we can be good and acceptable and in the perfect will of God. Lord, I'm not looking for a reason to quit. Brother Zach, thank you for that word. Praise God. Hey, whether I know where the halfway mark is or not, God, I feel like I came through so much. Is this the end of my trial or is this the eye of the storm and I got another 50% or more to go? I don't know what's... Sometimes we don't know where we're at, but thank God we can just choose. No matter what the situation is, I am going to be a part of this thing until God calls me home. God's going to be faithful and He's going to help me to be faithful. Hallelujah. There is victory in Him. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Even Jesus went into the wilderness. Yeah, it wasn't just a little Sunday afternoon trip that, oh, it's getting late, getting dark and scary, time for me to go home. Over a month, by himself, except for the devil. Oh, Jesus. We got to be strong, church. You understand that your enemy is real tactful? He's tactless, but he's a tactician. He knows how. He knows when. Oh, praise God. Praise God for relationship. It overrides. It overpowers. Praise God. It overpowers. Hey, does the Bible or does it not say you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you? Hallelujah. Why do we want to stay in that Holy Ghost power? Why do we want to stir it up? Why do we want to pray through it? Why do we want to make it live? That's because we got to have the power because we're not supposed to be defeated. Hallelujah. We sing in these praise and powerful worship praise songs today. He put the devil under our feet. He's given us all power over the power of the enemy because he did rise in victory, my Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Brother Zach. Thank you. Thank you. What a reminder. So good. Praise God. Praise God. Come on, Zion. Praise God. Praise God. Can you handle a little bit more word? Hallelujah. If I was preaching, we wouldn't even be halfway there yet. We might be more than halfway now, but it doesn't matter. When you're eating something good, you don't want to stop eating. Anybody in love with the Word of God? Hallelujah. Is it strength to you? Does it sustain you? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Let's just worship the Lord right now in Jesus' name. Lift Him up. Come on. Can you thank Him for the word we just heard? Hallelujah. Thank Him for the word. Hallelujah. He's been this with you, through this much with you in the storm. He's not going to leave you. Hallelujah. He's going to be there with you all the way, even when you don't feel Him. Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. to stand behind this desk, speak to you guys.
Jesus, help us today.
Let's just talk to God.
Jesus.
John 6:5 will be my first scripture.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. When Jesus then lifted up his eyes and saw a great company come unto him, he saith unto Philip, whence shall we buy bread that these may eat? Verse 8. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, saith unto him, John 6. There is a lad here which hath five barley loaves and two small fishes, but what are they among so many? And Jesus said, make the men sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down and number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were set down, and likewise of the fishes as much as they would. When they were filled, he said unto the disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. I want to talk very short about your lunchbox of potential. Let's just talk to God for a little bit.
Lord, we want you, Jesus. Oh God, I need you, Jesus. I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. God, be with us, Jesus. God, give us a hunger for your word, Jesus. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, I worship you. I worship you, Jesus.
I praise your name, Jesus. I praise your name, Jesus. You may be seated. I don't really have a foundation to lay today. I'm just jumping straight into my point. The definition of potential: qualities or abilities that may be developed and lead to future success or usefulness. The boy only had a lunch of five loaves and two fish. Considering that there was 5,000 people there, he did not have enough. He did not have near enough. We all have potential in us, given to us, put into us. And when the mom made the lunch, or the dad, they didn't know how God, they didn't know Jesus was going to make a miracle out of that lunch. So if you're a parent, put stuff into your kids that God can use, because you don't know what God will do with what you put into your kids. So just ask God what you want your kids, what to put into your kids, because you never know what he'll use what you put into them now. The thing, God needs our potential. We may say, well, I don't have much in my lunchbox. There's a lot of people in Tri-Cities, and I'm just me. I don't have anything in my lunchbox. When you give God your potential, when you give your potential to God, he will develop your potential into something that you would never think possible. Because you have to develop potential. You can't just give your potential and all of a sudden you're ready. God, you have to let God develop your potential. Some Bible scholars say there was 15,000 people there, once you count the women and the children. If my math is correct, if each person got five loaves and two fishes, God had to turn five loaves into 75,000 and two fish into 30,000. God will turn your five into 75,000. God will turn your 2 to 30,000. Don't become satisfied with 5 loaves and 2 fish. God has much more planned for us. We do not need to settle for what is in our lunchbox right now. We don't know what God can do with our potential. He'll develop it into what he wants. Jesus. Jesus wants to use our potential for the kingdom. We all have a lunchbox of potential, but what we choose to do with our lunchbox is what counts. We have to give our potential to God, no matter what we think of our potential. If we think it's not enough, if we think it's just not good enough. The scripture says that the boy had 2 small fishes and barley loaves. He could have made excuses. He could have said, all I have is 2 small fishes. And barley loaves were the cheap kind of bread. He could have said, oh, I don't have it. I need someone with 3 fish and the good kind of bread. Jesus can't use my lunch. But he chose to give it anyways. And we need to have that attitude. No matter what I think about my lunchbox, no matter if I think I have too much of this sin or too little of this ability, we need to just give it and let God develop us. The thing that made one of the greatest miracles in the New Testament possible was not that God blessed. It was partly because God blessed the food. But God cannot bless something that is not given to him. He can't develop you if you don't give yourself to him. You have to give yourself in order for God to use you. God will not come and snatch your potential and make you into something that you don't want to be. You have to give your life. You have to give it to him. Verse 12 says, when they were filled, he said unto the disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. If you've ever helped us, like downstairs, you know, after serving everyone, you're really tired. And the last thing you want to do after is to get all the leftovers, all the water bottles, all the dirty dishes, all the leftovers, all the uneaten healthy stuff. But why would God want the disciples? He said, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. Why would God tell the disciples to gather the leftovers? Because Jesus is not into waste. If Jesus is not into wasting bread and fish, how does he feel about your potential? If he's not into wasting bread and fish, how does he feel about your purpose? The definition of potential: qualities or abilities that may be developed and lead to future success. Maybe you think God doesn't want to use you because you failed him. Maybe you think God doesn't want to use you because you have nothing to offer. Any other reasons you might have don't really matter when you give your lunchbox to Jesus. You may think, oh, I don't have enough. I only have 2 fish and the cheap bread. I was not born into the right family. I don't have the right stuff put into me. You can go on and on. You may think God doesn't want to use you at all. But if you're not dead, then that's proof that God's not done with you. Jesus wants to redeem you. It doesn't matter what you think of yourself. It doesn't matter what others think of your lunchbox. Verse 10. One of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, saith unto him, there is a lad here which hath 5 barley loaves and 2 fishes, but what are they among so many? Even Andrew did not believe that God could turn that kid's lunch into a miracle. How did God respond to this question, the question of what are they among so many? He didn't even address it. He just ignored him, and he said, go seat everyone, and we're going to give them some food. It doesn't matter if others think you can be used. They aren't the ones who can develop your potential. God wants you regardless of any reason you can think of. Regardless of your age. Regardless of any reason you might think of. God wants to turn your fish to favor and bread to blessings. The music, please. You may think that God can't use your potential, but you're very wrong. The boy probably doubted if God could use his lunch. We need the mentality of, it doesn't matter what problems I've had in the past. It doesn't matter what I've done in the past. It doesn't matter if I think I even have anything to give. God wants to use our potential. He wants to develop us into a miracle. God does not use perfection or flawlessness. He uses willing people. He doesn't use perfection or flawlessness. He uses willing people. You can spend your life thinking, oh, I don't have enough in my lunchbox, so I'll just keep it to myself. Oh, I don't have the right things in my lunchbox. And you stay an ordinary person your whole life, thinking, oh, I'm not enough. And you waste your life sitting on the pew, just being a saint, not being used, not doing what God wants you to do, not climbing up the ladder, just sitting there, not helping the services, not being used, just sitting there thinking you're not enough. His lunch was small in his hands, but when he gave it, God multiplied it a lot. Your potential is small in your hands, but when you give it to God, he'll multiply it. When the boy gave, everyone was filled, and so was he. Because if my mom gave me 2 small fish and 5 loaves, I wouldn't be full. But when he gave, he was full, and he filled everybody else. How many people would have went home hungry if he didn't give? How many needs will go unmet if you don't give your potential? We need to let God use us, no matter if it's just cleaning toilets, no matter what, he'll develop us into what he wants in the future. Clay in the hands of me is worthless. Clay in the hands of a master potter can be turned into a willing vessel, a vessel that can be used for any purpose he wants. If God isn't into waste, how does he feel about your anointing? If God isn't into waste, how does he feel about your call? If God isn't into waste, how does he feel about your purpose? You may say, oh, I thought God only wanted to save people. I didn't know he wanted to save potential. God wants to save your potential. God isn't into wasting men or mandates. He isn't into wasting people or purposes. At the end of your life, and you're laying there, will you have accomplished everything that God wanted you to accomplish? Will you still have 5 loaves and 2 fish? Or will you have 75,000 loaves and 30,000 fish? You have to let God develop your lunch into something he can use for his kingdom. Let's all stand. Let's just talk to God for a little bit. When you get to the end of your life, are you going to do everything that God wanted you to do? Or are you going to have wasted your potential? Did you let God develop your potential? Or did you just keep it doubting yourself? You keep saying, oh, I'm not enough. I haven't done the right things. I'm not good enough. Or have you said, God, I don't care what's in my lunchbox. God, I'll give it to you. God, I'll let you develop it. It's what the boy chose to do with his lunchbox that made the difference. How many people are going to be affected if you don't fulfill God's calling for your life? Are you going to let God develop you? Or are you going to sit there? Let's just worship him. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus wants to redeem you. He doesn't want you to waste your life. He doesn't want you to waste your potential or your purpose. He doesn't want you to waste your anointing. He wants to use it. He wants to develop it into something that can be used for his kingdom. Jesus cannot develop something not given. You have to give it to him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. These are altars are open if you want to say, God, I'm here. Jesus, I want to give you my potential, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, come on, give it. Give it all to him, Jesus. I worship you, Lord. God, I'm not holding anything back. Jesus, I'm not going to hold back the bad stuff. I'm not going to hold back the good stuff. I'm going to let you use the bad stuff for your glory. I'm going to let you use the good stuff for your glory.
Everything I give.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Are you going to let God multiply your potential into something greater? Are you going to sit there your whole life doubting yourself? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, these altars are open. God wants to use you no matter what your excuses may be. God doesn't see you how you are right now. God sees you when you're developed all the way. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Final destination. Will God show you everything that you could have done? Or will he say, well done, that good and faithful servant? Will he say, I had so many things planned for you. I had so many miracles I wanted to do through you, but you didn't give. You didn't let me develop you into what I wanted you to be. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, give God your potential tonight. Give God your life. Let him use it for his purpose, Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Come on, let God develop you into something greater than what you are right now. He'll develop you into something that you never thought possible. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Are you taking advantage of what God has given you? Or are you wasting time? Hallelujah. Let God develop you. Let God use you. Clay is nothing unless you give it to the right person. And that person will develop it into a vessel that can be used for his usefulness. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Come on, let God turn your five loaves. Let him turn your five loaves into 75,000. Let God turn your two fish into 30,000. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus.
Withholding nothing.
Jesus, we want you in this place, Lord. I surrender.
You, everything I give to you.
Come on, God doesn't want you to waste your potential. If God doesn't want to waste fish, how do you think he feels about your purpose? If God doesn't want to waste bread, how does he feel about your blessings? Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Come on, we have to give it no matter the excuses we come up with. No matter the reason, give it to God. Let him develop you. He knows the flaws you have. He knows the problems you have. He wants to use that for his purpose. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You to waste your life. He doesn't want you to stay with five loaves and two fish. That boy never thought that was possible until he gave it to God. God developed it into something greater. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, I give myself away, Jesus, so you can use me. at the end of your life, is God going to show you everything you could have done? Or is he going to say, thank you for giving your life? Is God going to have developed you to what he wanted? Or are you going to waste your potential? Are you going to waste your potential thinking it's not enough?
Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed.
Come on, it doesn't matter what others think about your potential. It doesn't matter what others think. God wants to use you. He was just a little boy. That boy was little, but God still used him to do a miracle. That boy's one lunch fed 15,000 people. It says they were filled. They were filled all the way. God doesn't want to waste. God wants to use all he can. If no one else is going to give themselves, who is going to reach this world? If you don't give your potential to God, who is? If it's not us, who's it going to be? Who's going to reach your lost brothers and sisters? Who's going to reach those people that you know that none of us know? Who's going to tell your lost loved ones about the love of Jesus? Is it going to be you, or are you going to waste your life? Let God use you. Let God develop you. Lord, I give myself away, Jesus. Lord, I worship you. I worship you, Jesus. Come on, it doesn't matter if you think your lunchbox is not big enough. It doesn't matter if you think you have nothing to give. It doesn't matter if you think you have no potential. God will give you. He will develop you into what he wants.
Jesus.
Potential is something that can be used, that can be developed and used. Come on, let God develop you into a vessel that he can use for his purpose. Hallelujah. Surrender all, Jesus.
Everything I give to you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Withholding nothing.
Come on, will you give your lunchbox to God? Or will you keep it for yourself? Will you let others be affected by what actions you make? Or will you keep your lunch for yourself?
Everything.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God can develop something not given to him. You have to give him your lunch. Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus. The boy didn't just show up. Showed up and gave. We have to go from just showing up to church. We have to go from just showing up to church and keeping our lunchbox to ourselves. We have to show up and give our lunchbox to Jesus. Because how many people were affected when that boy gave his lunch to Jesus? We have to go from, I'm not enough, I'll keep my lunchbox to myself. We have to show up and say, here, God, here's my potential, Jesus. God, develop me into what you want, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus.
love you, Jesus. Taking full advantage of what God's given you already. If you've already given your potential to God, are you taking advantage of what He's given you? Are you doing all that God wants you to do? Will you go to the end of your life and God say, hey, I wanted to use you in this way. I had this action that I want you to take. Are you gonna? The saddest thing will be to get to the end of your life and God say, hey, you didn't give your life enough so I could use either way I wanted. I want to get to the end of my life and God say, you did everything that I want you to, I wanted you to do.
I gave myself away.
God, I give myself. God, I surrender all, Jesus.
I surrender all to you.
Doesn't matter what others think are possible, is possible in your life. God doesn't care what others think about you. He knows your potential. He knows what you can be developed into. Those people that think you can't be anything, they're not the ones who will develop you and use you. Jesus will use you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Will you be satisfied with 5 loaves and 2 fish? Will you spend your whole life with a small lunchbox? Not being full, not being used, just being there. Or are you going to give it to God? Let Him multiply it and affect others. Let's just talk to God one more time. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, I want to give you my all, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord, I want to give you my all, Jesus. God, I want you to develop me, God, into something useful. God, I have nothing on my own, God. I can't be developed into a vessel that you can use until I give it to you. Potential is small in our hands, but big in God's hands. Potential is small in our hands, but big in God's hands. God doesn't want you to waste. He doesn't want you to waste. He doesn't want you to waste your purpose, your mandate, your life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
see us through the storm and wants to use us at our best, and then says He'll do all the things we can't do to make us into that usable vessel. Do we have an excuse that'll stand at judgment day as to why we were not used? Praise God. Aren't you thankful He's on your side today? And he's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. When we do what we can, He'll step in and do all we can't. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, you're glad you made it to the house of the Lord today. Thank you. you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We give you praise. We give you praise, God. Thank you for coming every service. Thank you for being a part. Thanks to those of you who worked so diligently to... Y'all ever tried to lead a little kids choir? You ever even thought? Just yeah. There are many, many other things I can think to do. Praise God. But every musician, every singer, every portion, praise God. So may God bless you doubly this evening in Jesus' name. Praise God. We love you, everybody. Praise God. Adults, continue to encourage and support young people. All right? Praise the Lord. Zion kept talking about what we're gonna think about at the end of our lives. We don't want to get there and go, well, I was always hypercritical of others as I didn't support them. I just wanted to make my opinion known that they, you know, I could be doing what they're doing, but I could be doing it better because they're terrible at it. I know people like this. The majority of their life are behind them, and they're trying to be used by God, but they're just... They don't have much time to balance their scale out. Oh, Jesus, God, I don't want that to be me in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. So we love you. These young folks love you. Praise God. Are you proud of these young people, all these kids? Praise God. That's right. That's right. Thank you, youth workers and youth. All of you, in Jesus' name, love one another. Praise God.